TESS stands for Transiting Exoplanet Survey Satellite. And the basic idea is that it's an all-sky survey mission that will attempt to discover new exoplanets that are going to be transiting the nearest and brightest stars. In order to do this, it has to cover pretty much the entire sky and monitor about 500,000 stars during the two-year mission. We're going to be focusing primarily on Earths and super-Earths and covering the full range of stellar hosts, all the way from F5 to M5 stars. So basically from stars somewhat warmer and larger than the Sun to stars that are quite a bit cooler and smaller than the Sun. So that as a result of this survey, we will be able to provide targets for future missions. And in fact, I think it's fair to say that the targets that we'll be able to establish from the TESS missions are ones that will be a real resource for humanity for all time, because once you've carried out this survey and you established the nearby transiting systems, you pretty much define the ones that are going to be most useful for future follow-up missions. And the types of follow-up missions that will be relevant, or follow-up observations that will be relevant, are the spectroscopic things that are going studies that are going to be possible from the coming generation of extremely large telescopes, such as the EELT that the Europeans have funded, and also the giant segmented mirror telescopes that are coming on with several different concepts, including the TMT, which would be a 30-meter class telescope that would be in the northern hemisphere, and then a 20-meter telescope that would be in the southern hemisphere by two different U.S. consortia. And of course, the real creme de la creme for the targets that we're going to be looking at are going to be those that are going to be favorably positioned for JWST to survey. So that's the basic idea behind TESS. And to see what the implication is that this group of new sources that we will find have for the rest of exoplanet astronomy, this is the current discovery space that we can have. This is a three-dimensional plot with stellar type along this axis. So basically, we're talking about going from small stars at this end to large stars at this end. This axis is planet size, going from Earth-sized planets to planets that are quite a bit larger. And then this scale along the vertical axis is magnitude in the range that astronomers use, which is almost a natural log scale. And the key boundary that's shown here is 12th magnitude. It turns out that's an extremely useful boundary, because many of the objects that have been discovered by Kepler and the other ground-based surveys that have been going on, and also the COROB mission from Europe, are all in this region down below here. And the reason that that's an important boundary is if you do follow-up work on objects that are at this level or fainter, this is so really bright stars at the that are visible, that you can see with your naked eye, or up in this part of the chart, these are the ones that it takes a much larger aperture to study effectively. So basically, the region that's populated currently are those that are very difficult to observe. The targets that TESS will provide to the community, and that's why we think of this in some sense as the people's telescope, are those that really are in the upper part of this plot. So this is what happens with TESS, and this is the situation that we have without TESS. So the other thing is, in terms of thinking about the topic that we're going to cover in this part of the session, I was reminded to sort of go back to some of the things that we had done previously from our group. Many of the things that we're actually trying to do with TESS are based on the experience that our team has had working with a previous small satellite, HETE 2, which some of the people at NASA headquarters may certainly recall. This is a plot that actually shows the complexity index for a number of missions versus cost. It's a log-log plot, so there's a lot of scatter, but the scatter is very significant. This is from the Aerospace Corporation. And this little purple dot down in the corner, which has a fair degree of complexity associated with it, was actually quite a ways below the trend line. And that's something that we really want to try to achieve with TESS. And we did that by following a very rigorous KISS philosophy. We had a small, dedicated scientist and engineer mission team that worked on this program together for the period of 3 years to the launch in 2000. And then we continued to work with that with many members of that team for the 6 years of on-orbit operations. That having been said, you know, in the current climate, as we've learned from the other sessions and the other talks that have been given at this meeting, the mission challenges today are much more complex, and there certainly are lessons learned that we had from this previous mission. But on the other hand, as Roy Mazel commented in his talk with the quote from Sun Tzu, that is really an issue. Things are going to be more complicated. We can't be bound too tightly to the things that we've learned before, but we should try to stick with those best practices.